My fourth tire exploded in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. Then, too, it was raining and 50 degrees out. That would be the fourth busted tire in the 13th flat. 13 flat tires since pedaling away from here. Cape Disappointment, Washington. Alone, in the rain, and with the simple plan to pedal my bicycle.
Ice age heat wave can't complain. If the world's at large, why should I remain? Walked away to
well, here I am on the west coast. There's the ocean. It's raining a little cold. Bruce just drove off after he dropped off his stuff. There it is in a pile. A little nervous. I'm all alone now. Well, I'm 18 miles in. I got my first flat tire. I don't know what the cause is, but now I have to figure out how to change it.
So I had 7 flat tires in the first 2 days of riding, and it was raining, so I was wet. I was already sore from the bike seat, and I was cold, fumbling, trying to figure out how to change a tire. This woman walked over to me with her 2 grandsons and asked if I needed any help once. I said, no, I'm actually biking across the whole country here, just fixing a flat tire, I'll be fine. They emerged from the woods 2 hours later after picking $75 worth of mushrooms, and I was still trying to change the same flat tire they'd seen me on before. It was so pathetic. I looked so pathetic, and I felt pathetic. But I stayed with my friend John in Olympia. That made things a little better. And on this ferry ride, I met, over the Puget Sound, I met 2 people, a father and son, who were more pathetic than I was. They were biking across the country on a tandem bicycle. Sure, a great bonding experience, but the dad looked miserable because he was going to be pretty much pulling his son across the country and over the Rockies, and the son was going to be staring at his dad's ass while he did it. It must have rained every day for the first 2 weeks, and people tried to tell me, if you don't like the weather now, just wait 15 minutes. And that's fine if you're in a car underneath your porch, but what about when you're outside, going to the Cascade Mountain Range, where the temperature drops 15 degrees just inside the mountain shadow? It was cold. It was beautiful, but I had so many miles to go, and I was so sore. My butt was sore. I was either living in dread of the impending weather, or in misery during the weather.
You think it'd be fun and relaxing, you have plenty of time to think or whatever. But really, I mean, you just want to get it done with. You're just thinking how much longer until I can stop.
It's about 7:09, and I'm all packed up, ready to go out in the rain and head over Sherman's Pass. Second toughest pass of the trip, probably 5,500 feet. It's rainy out. It's cold inside the tent. It's probably even colder outside the tent. Definitely less than 50 degrees. I don't want to get cold or wet. I know I'm gonna.
Of the entire 4,300 miles, these were the worst 40 miles of the trip. It was the worst pain I experienced. It was 10 degrees and I was soaked going down Sherman Pass. I had to stop 4 times to warm up my hands enough so I could continue to squeeze the brakes. At the bottom, I had 2 breakfasts at the Steiner and drank 14 cups of coffee. Depressed about everything that had been happening in the cold and raininess of Montana and Idaho and Washington, and fearful of going over the Rockies and just the rest of the trip being the same. I didn't want to bike anymore. It became about not biking, and I start to slow down and try and just meet other people and try and gain some happiness from them, because I was not in biking. Staying at this restaurant in Rexford, I was looking out at the pouring rain. It was 8:30 at night. I knew where I would sleep, and this woman here convinced her husband to let me stay in their house for the night. And the same thing happened the next night in Whitefish, Montana, with this Bulgarian chick and her psycho boyfriend. It became about meeting the people and finding opportunities, excuses, not to bike. I continued over the Rockies, went up going to the Sun Road. I saw a bear and nearly turned around and went down all the way because of that. It was shrouded in clouds, the entire thing, so I couldn't see any glaciers, but I experienced that.
I'm at the top of Logan's Pass, Continental Divide, 6,680 feet. Highest point I'll get to on the trip. Pretty cold. A lot of snow. There's a visitor center, which may make the ride down a bit better than Sherman Pass, but I was freezing my hands and legs off. I'm gonna go there now. I've got a bit of luck. The bathroom's open, but no heat, and nothing else is open, so I'm just gonna hang out here in the bathroom, out of the wind for a couple minutes while my feet regain a feeling and I steam off a little. There's 12 miles down to Rising Sun. The sun is definitely not rising now.
And then it was over. The terrain became flat, the sun came out, and a 20 mile an hour due east wind was pushing me along. I ate breakfast for 3:50 and listened to Cowboy Corner before biking 200 miles halfway across Montana.
It's 5:47 and I've been going for about 170 miles today. I left St. Mary's in Glacier National Park this morning. After Browning, it's been all downhill, and the wind's really been against me, so I'm going for 200 today. See, I've been going for 8 hours already, and so we're from St. Mary's, half 200 miles, 30 to go.
The next day, June 15th, I wrote in my journal, "Suddenly, I love this song. I'm sitting in a park, jeans and a sweatshirt, no shoes, and not so much clean, but used to being dirty. I'm not paying rent or lodging or relying on oil, I live on a bicycle. I'm riding my bike across the country, and it's the simpleness of it that I love." It was around here also that I met a guy named Dale Oswald from Rochester, New York, who invited me to stay there, if I ever got there, and have some beer and ice cream with him. I called up Nate around this time too, and he said he was feeling recovered from mono enough to do the rest of the bike trip with me. And he said he'd fly out to here, Wilson, North Dakota, where I met this guy who owned this bookstore and introduced me to these ladies who fed me tons of food. They're both divorced women, fed me tons of steak and lasagna, and were pretty appalled that I've been living on ramen noodles and oatmeal for the past month. So I hung out at the bookstore, and my mom sent me some chocolate chip cookies, and I met Nate at the airport.
Well, Mr. Pike, you made it to Williston. How does it feel?
This is like a Kirby Pike home video. In 10 years now, we'll show up in the attic. And
it's good to see you.
It's great.